time to kick in.
Self-restraint for an hour. Hey, everybody. Hi. We're live, and I want to first welcome my guests who are going to be with me for the next hour or so. First of all, my very good friend, my chum, my pal, my sometime collaborator, the great Kristi Winters. How you doing, Kristi?
And don't forget March Buddy.
Yes.
Yes.
March Buddies for life. And our other guest, the man of the hour, the man with the power, too sweet to be sour. He is a podcaster, he is a blogger, he is a magician, and he is a friend to children everywhere. And he is Eli Bosnick. Eli, how are you, my friend?
Thanks so much, Steve. I'm good. Thanks for having me. Friend to children everywhere. Oh, the epitaph I'm afraid of.
I figured I would throw a Gamera reference in the
exactly
30 seconds of the show. Why the hell not? So we're here to talk about everybody's favorite subject, which is social justice and how much it everybody just loves to hear all about it. You know, anytime you mention, especially to like an atheist, secular, skeptical community, it's always met with universal praise and adoration and gratitude when you say, hey, I'm an atheist and I care about social justice and I care about equality and I think we should be intersectional. Everybody loves to hear that. It's a very popular subject. So that's what we're going to talk about.
Yeah, we're just doing the easy material today. Doing the easy stuff that everybody agrees on.
Playing to the cheap seats.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, crowd pleasing. Okay, so Kristi, actually, this whole deal was your brainchild originally. So do you want to take the lead?
Yeah.
And let me just not do very much work?
Okay, well, I want to first thank you guys both for agreeing to do this, and it's something that I've been looking forward to for a long time, and Eli's perspective is one that I'm particularly interested in because you live in a podcasting world and we live in a YouTube world, and one of the questions I want to touch on maybe a little bit later after I ask my first question is, you know, is there a ponage culture in podcasting? Because I don't really see it, but I'm not deep into it, because it seems like, you know, you have to be pretty intellectual to do a podcast because you have to talk in an interesting way for, you know, a period of time and consistently. It's not as easy to just record something and upload it. Whereas in YouTube, it is, and there's a lot of therefore ponage videos, and this poisons the YouTube interactions. So the whole frame of this is your perspective coming in from podcasting, also your experiences online with the atheist community and the skeptic subset of that community, so-called, that we're dealing with on a daily basis. But before we start, I want to get a little bit of your perspective based on an interview you did prior, and I'd like you to retell the story to Steve's audience. Could you recount the story of your friend who wasn't a believer, but she didn't call herself an atheist? And why she didn't, because of who she considered leaders of the atheist community, and then what impact that answer that she gave had on you and your activism.
Yeah, so a really close comedian friend of mine is African American and obviously female, and you know, she's very clearly a non-believer. She's been on my show. She's brilliant, brilliant. And we were sort of chatting, and it was when we had seen the movie. My show, God Awful Movies, is sort of a movie review show, Comedy Central roast of Christian movies. Very, very out there, very morning radio, very blue humor. And we saw the movie and we're sitting there and I'm talking about sort of how we're going to introduce her. And I was like, and do I introduce you as an atheist? And we had this really interesting moment that I had a bunch of times before that I still have. I get messages about all the time, which is someone will say to me who's a member of a minority community will say to me, oh, well, you know, I don't believe in God, but I don't use the term atheist. And I expect like the weird agnosticism apologetic or something like that. And they always go, cause you know, Dawkins, or cause you know, and they give a name of a YouTuber or a Twitter person or something. And I'm always very interested in that. And I realized that like, one of the things that I wanted, I was incredibly lucky in that my career was genuinely handed to me. Two buddies I knew from a retail job were like, hey man, you want to be on the second largest atheism podcast in the world? And I was like, yeah, thank you for the career. I have no illusions about my, illusions about my like own skill or my luck in this. And I realized like one of the things that I could bring to the table is trying to create a community that was a bit more welcoming, trying to a community that was a bit more loving, especially from my end, because anyone who's familiar with my work knows we're the dick joke guys. We're the, you know, if you'll excuse the term, we're the puppy rape guys. Like, that's what we call ourselves. And if you can come to our show and be like, oh man, like a running joke on my show is that I am have and continue to have sex with the dead body of Phyllis Schlafly. That is a running regular inside joke on both of our shows. And yet, when you hear me talk seriously, I want every member of a group to know, hey, you're loved here. You're protected here. You know, we're the good guys and we want you to be safe. We want you to be happy. And even though our humor is out there, even though our humor is all those things, you know, homophobic and sexist and racist and all those terrible things, you know, okay, I can hang my keys at the door and laugh along because these people get it. These people do want me to be happy. These people do want me to be healthy. And so, yeah, I can sit here and go, oh, Eli. And some of my best friends in podcasting who are socially justice minded can't listen to my show. They're just like, oh, I love you, sweetie, but you're, I can't. And that's fine. But that was an environment that I really, that conversation really sparked in me the desire to create an environment of safety, of welcoming for everybody in the community, truly everybody.
Well, I want to add something too. It's that it's not just your good intentions. It's that you, when you write and speak about social justice issues, it's clear that you know what you're talking about, that you're interested in these issues, that you're not just doing the thing where, like, you know, you're mean to people. And then in the last 5 minutes of the show, you say, but I don't mean nothing. You know right. what I mean? Like you genuinely are engaged with these issues, and it's not just sort of a get out of jail free card that you're saving for yourself. So you can say, oh, and in case you're offended, don't worry. I don't mean any of it. You're actually, right. you're walking the walk as well.
Right. Some of my best friends are women.
Exactly. My mother's a woman. We're not close, but she's a woman.
Yeah.
So Eli, why are you so passionate about talking about social justice?
I mean, aside from what I sort of already covered, one of the reasons why social justice is so important to me is I'm from upstate New York. I'm from Binghamton, New York. And I'm the child of two professors, but I was on the wrong side of these issues for a very, very, very long time. And it was only by the luck of having incredibly patient, incredibly understanding friends and educators that I ended up on the other side of those issues. You know, high school, Eli, and I have an open Facebook so people can see, like, can see the journey, if you will, but like, you can see me make it like high school, junior year, all the way up to like college, making like, how come women get to breastfeed in public if I don't get to poop in public jokes, right? Because I'm from upstate New York. They didn't know any better. And Bubba was just trying to get a laugh. And I had a series of friends who really helped me understand those things. And in understanding them, I realized that like, I have a rare opportunity, right? I am a comedian and people come to me for laughs and they look, you know, for whatever corner of the community I represent, I want someone to look to me and go, okay, well, look, I think these safe spaces sound super stupid. Everyone I hear talking about safe spaces says they're the worst thing in the world. But the funny guy, the movie guy I like, says they're okay. And he listens to me on a podcast and he listens to me do a debate. And look, I don't want everyone to be like, oh, ever so careful. You know, there's always the bedrock of not caring, right? You're always allowed to go, oh, okay, now I understand your point and I still don't care. But I want people to hear those positions and move them towards a place of empathy. Move them, because I honestly, in my opinion, and not to be too grandiose, but my opinion is in many ways the next big step of this movement, to use the intellectual term, is intersectionality, and to use the upstate New York Eli term, is welcoming more people, right? Is the more people we can get involved, you know, because you ask any average, you know, and something that we'll all agree on, social justice minded or not, is you ask any person, you know, why do you go to church or why do you do this? So often you get religion is useful. Religion creates community. And I want social justice intersectionality with atheism, or a more welcoming atheist community, to be part of that community. And the con scene is a great example of that, right? Anyone who's been a con, me and Steve met at Reason Rally, anyone who's been to a con, just, you're swarmed by love, right? You're just like, oh my, there's so many cool people to meet and hands to shake and like, it's a rock concert and everybody here is fun and everybody here is nice and like getting to hang out with David Silverman and, you know, run up behind Pan and be like, all right, you're Pan Gillette, like all of that. And like, that's all possible. And I want that to be possible for everybody. And I do want us to be able to disagree vigorously, vigorously. I want us to be able to disagree. I want to be proven wrong when I'm wrong. And I want to feel silly and embarrassed when I have bad ideas, right? And I want to be called out on those bad ideas. But I want to acknowledge the humanity of everybody while we're having those discussions. Everybody, even the people I disagree with. And I disagree with a lot of people vehemently. But one of the things that's really important to me, not just social justice minded, but in the way we learn to have conversations, is to remember that everyone's a human. Everyone's a real person with a family and a life, and that we're not just moving pictures on a screen, you know, and we're real people and we're wrong, right? Maybe I'm wrong about absolutely everything, but I'm still a guy with a wife and a pug. And if you sit and have a beer with me, you don't hate me. You know, the joke I do on the show is people tweet me all the time to tell me that they hate me. And I tell them, not as much as I hate me, because you don't have to take a pill every day to keep you from killing me. and that's the joke I tell. But the truth of the matter is, like, that humanity, that awareness, and that truly is the, I believe, the foundation of social justice. At core, social justice is about acknowledging the humanity and the empathy of your fellow human beings, right? It's not about the intellectualized term that goes along with it. It's not about the mental health resources. It's not about who's right and wrong and feminism and Black Lives Matter and, you know, ableism and whatever categories you want to fit into social justice. It, to me, it all boils down to this sense that the other is a human being. And they need my support. They need my love. And if I'm lucky enough to be in a position that one person wants to listen to me, then I should send a message that they are welcome here, right? If I've been lucky enough to make my living telling dick jokes, I owe it to them to make the community slightly better.
Yeah, absolutely. You're such a SJW.
I know.
Oh, yeah. God. I'm just getting all that vibe myself here.
Yeah, it's this
tingly spidey sense is going off.
People send me messages on Twitter just to say they disagree with me.
Yeah.
Like, that's all they say.
Yeah.
They say, I disagree with you. It would almost be better if they just said that they hated me. At least there would be some purpose to that.
So I'm addicted to arguing with those people. Like, I literally got tweeted at by a Nazi the other day, or a person who claims to be a Nazi. They were at Nazi. Fun. Right. They were at Nazi something and they were like, you're going to get gassed to death. And da, da, da. And I was just like, do you want to get on Skype and have a talk? Because I'm so I know. And I know that it's like me being in a position of like total invulnerability. I'm a New York upper middle class Jew who nothing ever touches. Like, and I do know that. Like, I don't want to shit on the people who are more upset by those situations than me. But like, at the same time, I'm always just like, what's that guy's day like? Like, that guy created a Twitter account and he was like, what name? Nazi man and that 411. And he was like, 411, because I love 411. I was like, all right, great. He loves Straight Out of Compton as well as this one, as well as being a Nazi. And then he gets and he found, it's not like I tweeted at him. He had to find me and be like, oh, there's a guy. He had to read my tweet and be like, I'm gonna tell that guy that he and his family are, and he sent it and he was like, good job, Dave. And then he fucking went, hey, Skipper, how'd you do at school today? I don't know, Dad, only a C. No, you gotta try harder than that, or I'll tweet it. Like, I'm and I got on with him and he was like, yeah, whatever. We get on and we spend the entire time talking about magic. Right. We talked at the beginning. I was like, hey, man. He was like, oh, really sorry. You know, I'm a white brotherhood member. And I was like, no, you're not. He was like, I'm a white brotherhood member. And I really, bad. And I was like, eh. And I was like, yeah, you know, I'm a magician. Like, I'm always interested in it. And he was like, oh, magic. You ever see that David Blaine fella? And I've worked with David a little bit when he's been in New York. And we spent 45 minutes, me and a Nazi, on Skype. And I'm talking, and I'm like, oh, no, but here's who you got to see, all right? If you're ever in Vegas, you got to check. And he's like, oh, I'm going there next year for work. And I was like, dude, you got to see me. And the moment we connected in that humanity, right? And look, did this guy behave badly? Of course, right? You know, I shouldn't reward that behavior. And I don't want it to be confused that I'm making the argument that people who pretend to be Nazis or are Nazis on the internet deserve, like, a Skype chat, right? We don't want to reward, win a free Skype chat by saying you're going to gas me to death. But by the same token, the moment that barrier gets breaking down, I just recognize the pain in this individual and what they're going through and how hard it is to be them and how easy it was for him to connect to me, right? How easy it was the moment I wasn't a tweet on a screen to recognize my humanity and to be sorry for the things he does. And look, did he have the capacity to be like, hey man, I'm really sorry. Like, I got some stuff going on at home. I'm not really, no, but you know, he's probably thinking about it, right? Next time he thinks about a Jew, he's got to think about me, right? He's got to remember me, the guy who recommended 3 good magic shows next time he and his kids go to Vegas, right? And then that is always, so that's my personal addiction. Sorry, I went down a rabbit hole.
No, it's fine. Yeah. It's fine. Well, actually, I mean, go ahead.
Oh, no, Steve, you go ahead. I just have another formulaic question.
Well, I was just going to say, I mean, it's a shame that there are so many people like that, that the problem can't be solved by just having a Skype chat with them. You know what I mean? Like that like what we have to figure out, what does it take to get people who do those sorts of things to take that moment to stop and realize there's a person on the other end, you know, without having to directly sort of seek them out and say, hey, come over here for a second. Let's have a talk, because there's not enough time in the day to do that. And it, you know, the problem is bigger than that. Like there was I don't know if you've probably seen the story. It was circulating. It's been circulating for a couple of years, and it came back around in January after Richard Spencer got punched, where people were sharing the story about the guy who made friends with people in the KKK and talked them out of being in the KKK. And they were sort of sharing this as the alternative, like, oh, don't punch them, be their friend. And I was sort of like, yeah, I mean, that's great. I admire that guy. What that guy does is tremendous. I couldn't do that.
Right.
I just couldn't. But that's not the ultimate solution to the problem. There, you can't just go out and make friends with every single neo-Nazi that you see and just be nice to them and recognize their humanity, and then the problem goes away. Like, it's a lot more complicated.
Oh, absolutely.
Than that, you know?
Yeah. And the whole Nazi punching thing went crazy. Like, I love my buddy Dan Errol. And like, I am as much at fault about this as anyone. Cause like when he first got punched, I think we all had the same reaction of like, ha ha, right? Not like I genuinely advocate violence, but just like, ha ha.
Yeah.
And Spencer got punched in the face. And then, so I made a joke. I was literally like, of course you could punch a Nazi. They're a Nazi. But that's like tweet jokes, boobity boop, be doop boop. And then again, my buddy Dan, who I love, was like, no. It is okay to punch a Nazi. And I was like, Dan, buddy, like, we're actually, buddy, we're not doing that. We're not the violent ones. And he was like, no, I do think that. And I wrote him privately and I was like, hey, Dan, like, what's going on, man? Like, see, break the bit. No hitting. We're the no hitting side.
Yeah. I love Dan too, by the way. I think he's great. But yeah, I stop short of that. You know what I mean? I go right up. I'm the person who I have said, you know, for a long time, and especially since the Richard Spencer punching thing happened, I said, look, if I hear about something terrible happening to a shitty person, my response is, oh, good. Because I just don't give a shit when shitty things happen to shitty people, you know? But I'm not going to say, hey, if you see a Nazi, go punch them. Or punching them is the ultimate solution to the problem.
Right.
And it, you know.
Yeah, it became so extreme. I actually wrote you mentioned my blog. I ended up doing a blog on like, you don't actually want to punch a Nazi, because there were people, like smart people. Again, I love Dan. Genuinely smart people who were like, no, it's okay to punch. And I was, so I wrote a blog about it, sort of breaking down the thinking that I felt wasn't happening in the genuinely recommending violence. And like, look, is there Schadenfreude? Yes. But like, if anything, right, whatever you want to say about Spencer, and look, I'm sure someone's going to point out that like, he's not a Nazi, he's a neo-Nazi. And yeah, he is not from the 1940s. I am so glad so many people.
He's not a member of the National Socialist Party, you guys.
Right. They took their phones out. Again, this is what baffles me. You took your phone out. You read me saying that you knew what I meant by Nazi. And you were like, actually, he's a white ethno, and then you sent it like I was gonna be like, holy fucking shit, and then flat. Like, but you know, what's fascinating to that about that phenomena to me is that what it gave, you know, sort of the anti-social justice crew was an opportunity to not talk about what was going. You know, not talk about what was going on at the time. It gave them an opportunity not to talk about the Women's March, you know, to not talk about the situations that were going on at the time, and to not talk about social justice and some of the things that they'd stood against, but to deal with the straw men that we gave them, right? And I count myself in that, like, you know, not blaming anyone. And I know I've picked on Dan a little bit, and it's because I love him, but like, not picking on anyone but me when I say that, like, I shouldn't have made that. If I had known people would take it seriously, I wouldn't have made that joke. And when I went on, I went on my buddy Thomas Smith's show, Atheistically Speaking, and I said, hey man, like, I made this joke. I think I'm wrong. Help prove me wrong. And we did. Like, by the end of the podcast, we talked through why the Nazi punching was a bad idea. Like, we worked it through and we chatted about that to the point where I was like, and there's this, and there's this, and there's this. And it turned into the blog that I eventually created. And, you know, something I've talked about quite a bit is, like, I feel like Nazi punching, quote unquote, pro-Nazi punchers, what we're not talking about or what they're not talking about often enough is the pain that they're in, right? Because we don't actually, like, look, I don't actually want Richard Spencer to get hurt. You know, the truth is, like, Schadenfreude aside, seriously, when we get down to it, Spencer's a human being. He's got a family, right? He's made some mistakes. He's made some terrible decisions. But there's no such thing as evil. We're the atheists. We're the ones who, right? We're the ones who know that evil's not real. And does Richard Spencer have some bad education? Yes. Do I want to educate him? Yes. But he's a human, and I don't want him to get hurt for his ideas. And it was my fault for being too flippant about another person's lived experience when what I should have said, when what I should have done was be bigger and better and say, no, hurting this person's wrong, and my pain right now, right? And the way I felt when Trump got elected and the way I feel with the global gag order, the way I feel about some of the laws that I see coming down the pipe and Mike Pence and all this horrible anti-trans garbage that's coming around the country, right? I'm in a terrible amount of pain about that, but I can't translate that into a war I don't want to start because they don't come for me. And it's what I said in the blog, but they're not coming for me, right? First of all, again, I'm an Upper West Side Jew with all the money and all the privacy and all the privilege, right? They're not coming for me. They're beating up some kid in their high school. And they're beating up some kid in their high school because I said the punching started. I said it. I did it. And that's on me, right? I declared a war that I'm never going to have to be a part of, right? And I got big ass friends. Right? I got giant friends. I'm my buddy from Tom from Cognitive Dissonance. I'll just, if the Nazis were like, Eli, we challenge you to a duel. Sure, I'll get my ass kicked by a Nazi. Absolutely. Are you kidding? Do you know how much credit that would give me? Just like, yeah, I'm the guy who got beat up by Nazis. Awesome. I'll take it. But I can't sign other people up for that. And when I'm violent and when I advocate violence, and this is something that the left, quote unquote, the left needs to take on, but our side of the argument needs to take on, is that we didn't stop and have that moment. And we should have. And we owed it to our audience. And we owed it, honestly, to our opponents too, or quote unquote opponents. They're not our opponents. But we owed it to the people who disagree with us to be intellectually honest enough to say, you know what, you're right. You're right about this. Violence is wrong. And look, did the comedy side of Eli enjoy Richard Spencer getting punched to Born in the USA? Is it my home screen? No, but I wish it was. You know, but that's sort of what I'm talking about, in that, like, recognizing that humanity, even on my own side, like my own faults, makes it so different for me.
If I could, Eli, you just touched upon the issue of your impact as a creator of content and your audience and people who follow you on Twitter. And you touched upon this topic earlier, and I wanted to get your thoughts on the responsibility that people have over their audiences and whether or not content creators can control or influence their audiences.
Yeah, and that's something that comes up a lot, and maybe it's because I'm a podcaster. I don't know. I can't speak. You guys are YouTubers. You know better than me, but I have a pretty significant audience. I have a pretty large audience. I don't want to brag. I don't want to throw numbers out there. I got a pretty large audience. I have an audience that is larger than some of the YouTubers that people argue can't control their audience, right? And we've never merited a rape threat. We've never merited a death threat. And everything I do is a takedown video, right? If you're not familiar with my content, like God Awful Movies is a takedown video of a movie and the person who does the movie. Like that's it. Like we just do a roast of the people involved, but I don't send that to anybody. And I'm very, very careful about what gets said to the people involved. And I'll give an example. I think I already mentioned like a running joke on my show is that like my character, quote unquote, and I'm not a character, but I'm like a slightly exaggerated, sillier version of myself, is having sex with Phyllis Schlafly's dead body, that I dug her up and I'm having sex with her. And one of my fans, who meant well, right, wasn't doing like a mean thing, he wasn't trying to troll, he tagged the Phyllis Schlafly Foundation in a tweet about it. Right. He was like, he tagged them and he was like, Eli, this puppet act has gone too far, which again, it's a funny joke, right? It is a funny joke, but like her family reads that. And I don't want that to visit their family, right? My humor, my jokes are for my audience and by my audience. And if the result of my humor was to send people out to cause pain, I honestly don't know what I would do. I genuinely don't know what I would do. I mean, I'm very lucky, right? I've been doing this for 2 years. The guys who started the show before me have been doing it for 3, and we've never caused that kind of thing before. I don't know how. I will say people who I have talked about, right? People I've made joked about, I've made jokes about, like in the podcasting family. And I'll just give a little example. We do a roast for charity every year. We've done it 2 years in a row. It's called Vulgarity for Charity. And the first year we did it, we got asked to roast another podcaster. And I did a roast of him and he didn't like it. It really hurt his feelings. And he tweeted at me and ended up doing an episode about it. About how hurt he was. And he tweeted at me and I was just so sorry. I was so incredibly sorry. Like, cause I'm a comedian. Like my whole thing is jokes. I want to make people laugh. I want to make people happy. Right. Even though I'm taking down other stuff. And like, look, David R. White makes homophobic, sexist, racist, horrible movies with terrible messages. And I do want to talk about those things. I want to tear them apart, but I want to tear them apart from my audience. I don't want to bring that to David R. White's door. And that's a huge differentiator for me. So when people say like, I can't control my audiences, like again, I can only speak from my own experience. I've always been able to control my audience. My audience is fairly sizable. And I've always been able to control them because I want them. Like it's for us. It's a joy. Like our my job, right? And I'm a comedian. I don't talk about serious things. And I'm also not on YouTube. So like, I do want to clarify, like I can't speak to what your audiences do. And it's not fair of me to make that judgment because I've never done it. I have 2 videos on YouTube and they're both like, hey everybody, look at me talk too much with my hands in front of a bookcase, right? Like there's nothing sensible. I don't make my career on YouTube, but and I also don't ask to be taken super seriously. A lot of the time when I do interviews, I'm very careful about the things that I say, because when I am asked to be taken seriously, I do want to make sure. When I did my social justice debate with James Lindsay on Atheistically Speaking, I did a 4-hour debate with him. I said at the beginning, and James was I love James, by the way, we disagree on everything, but I love James. And if you want an alternate person to me, like check him out. He's a super duper smart dude, doctor, brilliant, brilliant guy. We disagree on everything. And we had this great debate. And at the beginning, I was like, hey, like, because I just had more Twitter followers and I knew how many people listened to my show. It was my first big debate. And I was like, hey, don't tweet mean things at James. Like, if you disagree with James, just keep it to yourself. I said to James on the thing, I was like, James, if you get a mean tweet, text me. Like, email me, message me. And he was like, I don't need to do that. I'm a big boy. Like, and again, he turned it down. Like, and it was, and look, it was obviously awkward. It was obviously awkward for me to be like, and if anyone's mean to you, you just tell me and I'll come in, I'll snap their neck like Splinter Cell, lower down from the ceiling, and I'll just karate chop them until they're dead. But it's because I want to send a message to my audience that no matter how seriously I advocate against or for something, I don't want abuse to be part of that. And like I've said, I have been very lucky in that I haven't caused it yet. Maybe someday I will, and I don't know how I'll deal with it, but I know that the way I deal with it now on the day-to-day is that when I see people tag, even Ken Ham or Ray Comfort, who just get a million hate tweets a day, if I'm tagged in that, I say, leave Ray out of this, right? Leave Ray out of this. Because again, like, I disagree with everything Ray says. Ray's a homophobe, he's a racist, he's nuts. Right? He makes those crazy films, forgive the term, but like, he makes those nutty films, totally cuckoo films. And like, I want to take, and I love taking down Ray's films. I really do. And I'm not saying that like my takedown videos are in some way bad, but like, he is also a guy and I don't want to bring this to his door. I mean, I don't know if that makes sense. Again, I'm in such a different community that I do think I have it easier and I don't want to pretend that it's not, but like, I do want to point out that like, when it comes to controlling your audience, I think a big part of it is accepting and understanding that the people you disagree with, even Ray Comfort, are human beings and don't deserve abuse. And you can lead by example, right? I say, I mean, look, I've had 2 takedown videos of me so far and I don't respond to them because they were just, well, actually one of them, I was like, hey, do you want to have a conversation? And the second one was just so mean spirited. I was like, okay, I'm just not going to acknowledge it. Like, it's not worth my, this person doesn't want to talk to me. This person just wanted to hurt my feelings. And like, it worked. There you go. Like, you said mean things about how much I move my hands. Like, it's done. It's over now. But like, my answer is always, you know, in those situations, if someone wants to have a conversation with me, right, I want them to know that like, it's a safe place to have a conversation, right? And that my audience isn't going to abuse them and that they can talk about those ideas and that they can call me wrong and they can be like, dude, you're wrong about everything. And like, and I have, so for my blog as an example, and sorry, I've been talking forever, so shoot me with a dart if I...
No, this is why we had you on, because we wanted to just listen to you talk live and ask you questions. So keep going.
For my blog, so I have 2 guys who disagree with me on absolutely everything. And they're both anonymous, and they're both Twitters, and they're good dudes. And we just disagree on everything. And they review every blog I do, right? Total anti-social justice guys. And they see every blog before it ever comes out. And look, most of the time they go, oh, you're so wrong. You're so stupid and wrong. I hate you. And I'm like, yeah, I know. And that's fine. But it's because I want to understand. I never want to find myself in a position where I'm not empathizing. And again, just to reference the blog again, like, the reason why when Milo sort of had his fall, I came out with a blog called The Fall of Milo, Gross Indecency, The Fall of Milo Yiannopoulos, in which I compared him to Oscar Wilde's fall. Mm-hmm. And the similarities are actually, if you know the story of Oscar Wilde, are strikingly similar, right? Wilde is this sort of outrageous provocateur who everybody loves, and he's so gay and he's so sassy. And then in trial, he's like, oh, no, it's totally fine for older men to have sex with young boys. I mean, that's what he, and I'm not trying to make points about Milo. Like, that's not the point. I'm talking about Wilde, and we have transcripts of Wilde. What Wilde says is the love that dare not speak its name is a love between older men and younger men, right? And the jury turns on him, right? And rather than this sort of outrageous publicity stunt, which is him suing a guy for saying he's gay, like, again, this is Oscar Wilde, the Elton John of his time, is like, oh, you called me gay? I'm going to sue you, honey, right? It's hilarious, right? It's a publicity stunt. But instead, they turn on him, and he goes to jail. And while he's in jail, the young lover in question leaves him. And the parallels of noticing, and again, like, I celebrated Milo's fall because I don't want him to victimize people, right? I don't want him to hurt people anymore. It matters to me that he doesn't hurt people. But at the same time, I was aware that, like, Milo lost his book deal. That's a guy. You know, he's wrong. He lacks education. You know, he has opinions that I disagree with, but he's still a human being. And so I find more and more, as I get more of an audience, one of the things that I find myself serving as a voice for in social justice is this argument for empathy, this argument for truly understanding what other people are talking about and where they're coming from, even when we disagree, and knowing that they want a better world. They want a better world, and they might have a disagreement with me about how it comes. And if my audience is going to make them afraid to ask those questions, is going to make them afraid to challenge me, or, you know, do what they want to do or be what they want to be, then I have not served my job, right? Just as social justice, and I'll speak to, you know, anti-social justice people, and I have to be careful about this. Like, I'll give a perfect example of this. I have a guy who really doesn't like me, and we were tweeting back and forth, and I got really mad, and I behaved badly in the tweet conversation. And he was like, whatever. And he told me his job and where he worked. And one of my fans saw it and sent me a picture of his Facebook and was like, do you want me to call this job and get him fired? And I said, absolutely not. Please, please, please do not do. And look, I was mad. Like, I was just mad because I was like, eh, you're wrong about things, right? And I realized, like, one of my followers with that was like, hey, I did the research. Do you want me to get this guy fired? Do you want real consequences for this guy, for what he says? And I was like, no. And I private messaged him and I was like, hey, man, one of my listeners found this. I'm going to delete all of my tweets to you. Like, I don't think anything's going to come from it. Like, please check in with me. I will absolutely, like, cover for you if you need me. And like, this is a guy who was saying, in my opinion, really vile stuff, right? But I had welcomed him into my world. Mm-hmm. And part of my world, the choice that I make for my world, is that you get to be like, fuck you, Eli, you're wrong, right? Without those consequences. So talking about controlling your audiences, it was one of those situations where I was like, hey man, like, this is an audience member who is coming for you. And I don't want that. I don't want this to ever visit your door. And Steve, I'm sure you've heard me talk about this before because I sort of use you as an example. But I don't know how I would feel if someone attacked my wife the way people have attacked yours. And yeah. I know I'm in a different community, but I love my wife. I wake up every morning and I make my wife coffee. And my wife plays the ukulele at 3 a.m. and my wife watched Steven Universe on YouTube and like gets super feminist about it. And she's like, just so you know, that's really open-minded what they did. And I'm just like, ah, right. Right. And my wife has all these little things, but that's the love of my life. I would take a bullet for her. And to know that someone does that because of what I said.
Yeah.
Because of the garbage I spewed at him. I don't care how wrong I am. Right. I could never picture going after someone in that way. And I never want to be the cause of it. I never, ever want to be the cause of it. And I know it's a different community here. I do. I know it's a lot more poisonous. I know that that comment section is ticking away and that it's a lot easier to just type and go than it is to download a show and be like, all right, well, listen, an hour and 45 minutes. Okay, now fuck you, you're right? You know what I'm saying? Like, again, I don't understand what that's like, and I can't pretend to relate to that community. I know it happens from our side as well as the right, and I don't want to pretend that I don't understand that. But I do know a lot of the time, and like, Steve, it's no secret. People tell me all the time. Like, I got featured in a video, like, that was a takedown video of you, and everybody was like, oh, you better watch out. You better watch out. He's coming for you. It was Baron. It was Baron. Oh, and yeah. I tweeted at him, and I was like, hey man, like, if you ever want to have a conversation, I'm totally up for it. And he was super nice, right? And it's because look, I can't speak to your experience. And Steve, you've gone through, and Kristi, you've gone through stuff that I haven't. So I don't want this to come as like, I get along with everybody because it's never come to my door, right? And that's what some people watching this are thinking. But like, there, a part of this has just been that I've always been like, hey man, if I'm wrong, prove me wrong. If I'm dumb, tell me I'm dumb, but like, stay away from my family. You know, like, it's such a silly thing to say, but like, what could I possibly have done to merit it? There are terrible again, Richard Spencer is a terrible guy who has done terrible things, and I don't want anyone to be mean to his family. I don't want that to happen to, I don't want that to happen to Ken Ham. I don't want that to happen to, you know, any, I don't want that to happen to Donald Trump. You know, some people all the time are like, oh man, I can't wait to hear what you do about Baron Trump. And I'm like, nah, I don't have any of those jokes. It's funny. I managed to have enough material without picking on an 11-year-old. I'm managing to do a show once a week without picking on that kid. Right. Because again, as much as I disagree with him, as much harm as I think he does, and I think that I don't want that to enter his life. And I think that philosophy communicates in my work, as dirty as my work is, as blue as my work is, and as dark as my work is. And I want to point that out. I have said way meaner stuff about David R. White than anyone's ever said, like in a takedown video about me. A, because I'm more imaginative, and B, because I've dedicated my career to it, right? But like, if it visits him, it's too far, right? There's no right. too far in the comedy club, but that's because everyone walked in the door, right? My podcast is a comedy club. Everyone walked in the door knowing what I was going to do, knowing what I was going to say, knowing what I was going to be about, and they get to turn it off. They get to turn it off. And if I've hurt someone, and we were talking about this a little bit before, you know, I get messages all the time. Because my show, again, racist, homophobic, sexist, all those things. And people will write me and say, hey, man, I was really hurt by this. I was really hurt by that. And my answer is always the same. I say, hey, our show is a Comedy Central roast of Christian movies, right? There's no holds barred. It's a comedy club. There's nothing safe. There's nothing left at the door. But if you felt attacked by that joke, if you felt like I don't care about you, if you feel based on that joke that you're not welcome here, I'm sorry. Because my intention wasn't to make you feel that way. And 2+ years of doing this job, everyone who I've ever done that with has gone, oh yeah, no, it's fine. I'm not mad. It's okay. It's just, you know, I thought I'd point it out. And that's often what it is they want to be heard. We were talking before the recording. I was on Seth's show, Seth the Thinking Atheist, talking about safe spaces. And I really like Kat Black's work. And she tweeted the show with like, thought this was a good show, disagreed with a lot of what Eli said, and I was just like, but I love you. Like, but don't disagree though, right? And but there was also a defensive quality too, right? And that's what I think a lot of the enmity in our community or the YouTube community comes from, is when we get called out, it's really hard. And like, I had a moment where I was like, well, tell me I'm not good at talking about safe space. I've been talking about safe space for a year. Like, and it was really hard for me to be like, okay, open to any feedback you have. And like, I get silly demands like that all the time. You know, I have people who tell me like, you can't use the term spirit animal, or like, don't, that's blah, 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 blah. Right. And people say silly things to me all the time. And I'm always just like, hey, I'm sorry that hurt your feeling. And I mentioned this earlier, there's the bedrock of fucks, right here. And eventually I'm all out, but then I'm done talking. Like, I don't want to attack that person. I'm just done. And the example I'll give of this is, and again, I don't want to pick on her listeners because Kat is, or viewers, because Kat is so sweet and I love a lot of her work. But one of her listeners obviously saw that tweet and they messaged me. And we were talking back and forth and I was asking questions, how can I be better? And the listener was like, well, you know, as a white man, you need to understand that you can never actually care about the experience of African Americans. And I was like, never. And she was like, yeah, as a white man, it's always a Poe. And I was like, so you think I'm pretending? And she was like, yeah. And I was like, oh, I'm not. And she was like, well, I'm sorry, I just don't believe you. And I was like, well, I'm really sorry you feel that way. And she was like, apology not accepted. And I was just like, that's silly, delete, all right. On with the- and like, on the one hand, we do need to acknowledge that like, the people who are on the other side of the conversation than us, you know, and I don't talk to those guys, you know, they don't usually want to talk to me, but, you know, they're getting a lot of that too. They're getting a lot of that hate. And I can empathize with being tired of that. I can empathize with the exhaustion that comes with that, the exhaustion that comes with being called, you know, racist or sexist, and not from my work, because my work is sort of separate. But like, as I said, when I started out, I had different ideas than I did, and I was very lucky. No one called me a sexist, but I almost promise you this, and I'm not saying this is the obligation of anybody on our side, but like, I promise you, if someone had been like, Eli, you're a fucking racist piece of shit, I hope you die, I hope everyone fires you, and I hope everyone closes you out, and you lose everything you've ever loved, I'd be moved further to the right, right? And the example I use of this all the time is Sam Harris. I think, I love me some Samala. I love Sam some Samala. Samala Bubala. I love some Sam, but I truly believe, and I'm ready for pushback on this, I believe Sam is as right-leaning on certain social justice issues as he is right now because we're the side that sent death threats to his daughter. Mm. Right? Just as I feel about my wife, that's his kid. Right? We're the ones who put his name on a list that jihadis look at for people to murder. We're the one who made him get personal security for his home. You know? And I don't know if he could talk to me and my side about why he's wrong about pronouns. Like, how do you come back from that? You know, and maybe I'm totally crazy and wrong. And again, I'm speaking from a position of like real, like I said, luck. But when I see Sam a lot of the time say some things, and I disagree with Sam on a ton. You know, I listen to some of the stuff he says on his podcast, and I'm just heartbroken. I'm heartbroken by it. I genuinely am. I'm heartbroken that someone who loved End of Faith, which is such an incredible book, or Letter to a Christian Nation, which is such an incredible book, who's trans, might go on and hear that Peterson podcast and hear him talk about trans people in the way he did and feel like, oh, this community's not open to me. I'm not welcome here. I don't belong here, right? That breaks my heart. But at the same time, I can't help but lay that, not at my door, because I always understood what he meant, but I can't help but lay that slightly on our side's door, right? Because he was, before he said stuff that in my opinion was truly problematic, was truly, and I know people hate that word, but like, was truly a problem. Oh yeah, not here, but generally.
I love that word.
Yeah, exactly. Before he said stuff that was truly, sort of a problem, we were already calling him names. We were already closing him to what it is we had to say. And, a lot of listeners have reached out to Sam and said, Sam, you should talk to Eli. And I would love to talk to Sam because I don't know how often Sam's exposed to someone who talks about trans rights or safe spaces or trigger warnings. I just know that, like, the first people who were on this side of the issue were also the ones calling him a racist and putting his daughter at risk. You know, so I know it's a long, 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 long answer, but it all gets down to this idea of like what I consider my responsibility to be is, and look, I'm sure I know people watch your videos to disagree with you because they want to make takedown videos and they hate you, but like, those people, I want to be safe as well. And I want to be safe. And I want someone to say you're wrong and I disagree with you. And I want them to say it without being called names. And I want to be safe to say, I want to be safe to be wrong without being called names, without being abused and harassed. And if I can't control my audience, if I were unable to control my audience, I don't know what I would do. I've been very lucky. And I want to say, like, again, just to, because I don't want to blame either of you. I know you've had listeners do things you don't like, and I know that's sort of gone that way. And I know that there are anti-social justice YouTubers who have had things go that way. I met a fairly popular one at a con, and I was like, hey, man, you're listeners. And he was like, dude, I fucking try. Like, and we had a real human moment where I was like, you got to try harder, bro. Truly. Like, and we're sitting there, and we disagree on everything, this dude. And he was like, you have no idea how much of my time I spend telling people not to do this. Like, you have no idea how much of my time I spend just telling people not to behave that way. And like, there's only so many hours in the day. So I do want to say, like, as a non-YouTuber, I don't want to pass all the judgment. I just know that, like, what I consider my responsibility as a podcaster and a person with a following to be.
Yeah. And, my philosophy about all of that has always been, for the most part, to each their own. You know what I mean? Like, cause I know, like you said how, you reached out to Baring and had a conversation with him, and I would never do that. I wouldn't give him the time of day, but I also know that my way is not the only way to do it, and I'm friends with people who are in the YouTube community, as is Kristi, who are much more open to having conversations with people who I consider to be just toxic professional pieces of shit that I wouldn't piss on if they were on fire. And that's fine. If that's what, if you're open to that, that's what you want to do, then I hold no judgment in my heart against you.
Right. And I think it's fair to say that's your lived experience as well. One of the things that I talk about quite a bit is like, one of the reasons why I speak up about trans rights is it's a lot easier for me to defend trans people than it is for a trans person, right?
Oh, absolutely.
To hear like, oh, well, you've got a mental illness, right? You're just sick. Well, no, actually, it's I know it got changed in the DSM-5, but that's really just politicians trying to cater to people. Like, you're actually sick and you need to go get, or we don't even need to use trans. We can use homosexuality, right? Yeah. When I talk to Christians who say that homosexuality is a disease and they need electroshock therapy to cure them, right? And one of the things that I want to say, and this comes up a lot, Steve, you've heard this criticism, I'm sure, so it's not new to you. One of the criticisms that I got when they were like, oh, you're friends with Steve, like how dare, and I was just like, oh, is like, you've had your own experiences. And again, like, I didn't go through what you went through. I didn't. I can't fathom it. I can't fathom what some of my friends in the social justice community have gone through. So I don't want my, like, I'll talk to anybody attitude to come across as like, Steve, you should talk to everyone. Like, Kristi, get on with everyone who's ever tried to hurt you and your family. Like, get those death threats going, girl. Like, I can only speak for myself. I've been lucky enough to be in this position where it hasn't crossed lines for me yet, but maybe I'll change my, I hope not. I hope no one ever does anything bad enough.
I hope so for you too.
Yeah.
That you never have to change your policy.
Yeah. And I don't want to, but I don't want anyone to watch this and go, oh, so Eli thinks because he can talk to whoever that I should be able to. And that's the obligation. You know, I want to be able to do the things that people don't feel like doing, that people don't want to do. I want everyone. And that's true of anti-social justice people too. I know a lot of anti-social justice people feel comfortable talking to me in a way that they don't for certain social justice advocates because of the way I talk. I don't use intellectual terms. I'm a dummy. I'm so easy to make fun of. So if it ever goes wrong, you've got this face to work with. I look like a shaved Harambe costume. So it's very easy to break down if you need to. But you know, I just wanted to clarify, like, I don't ever blame anyone for not wanting to have those conversations. I want to explain why I come from a place of being able to have them.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Like I say, I mean, and you're right, you know, having people attack your family changes things, you know what I mean? And, once upon a time when I had a much smaller audience, even than the one I have now, and the audience I have now is not huge, you know what I mean? Like, Eli, your podcast audience is many times greater than mine here on YouTube. But when I had an even smaller audience, you know, I was very much of the same philosophy, you know, like, oh, let's reach out and talk to people, let's have conversations, and you know, let's bridge the gap. And you know, and what changed that for me was first realizing that a lot of the people who say they want to have debates or conversations actually aren't interested in that at all. They just want to attack people. And B, people attacking not just me and not just me personally, you know, instead of my arguments or whatever, but attacking my wife and attacking my family and you know, that changes things. But, you know, as I say, if someone else find some value in reaching out to someone who has made attack videos about people and who I consider beneath contempt, that's up to them. That's up to you. You know, it goes both ways. Like, I'm not saying you're saying your way is certainly not the only way to do it or the way that everybody has to do it. And I'm certainly not saying that my way is either. You know, like you mentioned David Silverman earlier, there are times when I find David Silverman to be, you know,
too Jewish.
Every single time. Like, God, dude, tone it down a little.
Tone it down. Are you an atheist or are you a Jew? You,
I'm confused.
Stop trying to adjust the air conditioning at Reason Rally. It's outside, David.
Choose a side, David. No, but there are times when he's too harsh for me. When I feel like, man, you're just pushing people away. You know what I mean? But at the same time, I'm glad he's there. Like, even though that's not my way, and even though that's not how I approach things, it's important to me that we have people on our side who are sort of more attack dogs. You know what I mean? And I'm glad that there are also people like you who make more of an effort to reach out and be more sort of to project more empathy than I do. You know what I mean? Because to me, it's more like, oh, that sounds nice. You know, I wish I still had that in me. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. And again, like, yeah, absolutely. You're totally right. And one of the things that comes up a lot is like, everyone feels obligated to debate, and debate is a terrible way to learn things. right? Debate is something that atheists are addicted to because we all watched Intelligence Squared and we all watched Sam beat up Craig and we were all like, yes, this is how I will win. But like, the truth is debate's really bad because it's personality driven. Mm-hmm. And what I say to people all the time is like, look, I'd be an amazing Holocaust denier. Because I'm fun. And the best example of this is watching Joe Rogan beat that NASA guy at whether or not we landed on the moon. Right. Yeah. That clip is perfect because Joe's just like, how come you can't answer this question? And the guy's like, I am a scientist. Everyone's supposed to listen to me. Right. And he destroys him. And as a and I was a 9/11 truther for years in college. And luckily, my co-host, Noah, talked me out of it, like, but very gently. But like 9/11 truth debates, if you go on YouTube, the non-9/11 truthers, they don't win. They don't win because like the people from 9/11.org and stuff like that, they're just better speakers. They ask questions that are hard to understand. They require certain amounts of knowledge to understand. And look, I was watching the William Lane Craig debates, and then I watched some 9/11 truth debates, and I was like, well, that's an example of someone who's obviously right in the same way. And so one of the things that I do a lot of the time when I'm speaking to people who are quote unquote anti-social justice is I just have conversations, right? If someone says, oh, I want to debate you, I'm like, what, Oxford English style? Like, what are we doing, policy? We're doing Frederick Douglass? Like, what do you want to do? But like, if I get on someone's show and we shoot the shit and we talk for 45 minutes or an hour about our lives and who we are before I get a chance to talk about social justice, then they'll go, hey, you know, maybe you got a point there. Or yeah, you know, might be right. You might be wrong, or we'll have so much better of a conversation. So again, without judgment at all, like my starting point, and like, look, I've seen some videos. I'm trying not to use specifics because I like to talk to people, but I've seen some videos and I've just been like, Dave Rubin. He's never going to watch this. I watch Dave Rubin a lot of the time and I'm just like, I don't see where you're coming from at all, buddy. Like, I don't get it, man. You know, and I, something you've seen me say quite a bit, Steve, because I know we're Facebook friends, is I'm always like, aren't we supposed to be the good guys? Weren't we the good guys? Like, and I feel like Batman villains sometimes. Like, I'll see tweets and I'm just like, oh, we're Batman villains. The atheists are Batman villains. Like, look at the crying college students. Meow, meow. And I'm just like, why? Why? Even if you disagree, why are you happy? Why are you happy at other people's? And so, you know, one of the things that I try to reach out to is people's empathy and their humanity. Because we're, again, like, as hard as it is to picture Baring, for example, right? Who, again, like, I know you guys have very different perspectives of, and again, Baring hasn't come for me. Like, it's not fair of me to be like, oh, well, here's why. But like, that's a human being. Right. And maybe we disagree on some stuff, but like, he's a human and there's no, and he's not evil. Right. There's no such thing as evil. Right. He's just got different points and he cares a lot about them. And I want to reach that human being and maybe I'll be wrong and maybe I'll be right. But I want to have that conversation because it's the element of his humanity that I know I can reach, that we can always reach with each other. And the internet has taken that from us. You know, I said in one of my essays once, you know, the internet outstripped the parenting, just time-wise. It outstripped the parenting in that, like, I was very lucky in that my father growing up was like, never be anonymous online. That was the one rule. He was like, you can look at porn, you can do whatever you want, you know, get on there, Guru Fang G, get on there, right? But he was like, no, nothing anonymous. And I've never been anonymous, which is actually super awkward because a lot of porn accounts are in my name. So like the 18th page of Google is like, oh, that's your porn account, huh? And I'm like, yeah, sorry. Sorry about that. Sorry. But like, I've always believed in that lack of anonymity. But it does mean that like everything I say with my heart. Mm-hmm. I say because I mean it. And I think a lot of the time, and look, anonymity does serve its purpose for certain people. You know, there are my friend Ina, who does a wonderful show, you know, she has to be. And there are a ton of people who have to be. And I'm not shitting on anonymity, but I do say that it motivates a lot of the way I speak because I'm Eli Bosnick on Twitter. I'm Eli Bosnick on Facebook. I'm Eli Bosnick on my show. Right. And you got to look at me, the guy. And if you look at me, the guy, and you're like, hey man, fuck you, fine. But you got to say it to a person, Not a figurehead, not a statue, a human being who genuinely, like, has wants and needs and was once wrong and is willing to be wrong all the time. Is always willing to be wrong because I want to welcome the maximum amount of people, you know? And so that's where I come from that allows me to do that. Again, I haven't had your guys' experience, so I feel a little shitty being like, oh, that's so easy. But I want to apologize in advance as someone who hasn't tolerated any abuse for being like, talking to people's great.
Well, I would say that if you and Baring have a conversation about safe spaces and you can get him to a middle ground on safe spaces, I will watch that on repeat. I will donate money to a charity of your choice.
All right.
You can get him to that.
Well, I messaged him. I know he's a busy dude. I'll reach out again and see if he wants to chat. I think he was just making sure that I wasn't like making attack at the time. Again, I tweeted him. He was like, yeah, let's have a conversation. And I was like, here's a bunch of my stuff. Like, also, you're going to get a stupid tweet auto message from me. I apologize. Like, if you ever want to talk, let's talk. And I didn't hear back, but I think it was just because there wasn't that much content to take down. I don't know.
There's a mysterious force on YouTube, and Baring always knows when he's mentioned in the video. So I'm sure this will come to his attention.
Well, Baring, if you want to talk, I'm happy to talk.
He's too busy attacking teenagers. He'll get around to you eventually.
Or another video about me. That's a very popular.
Yeah, exactly.
About every fifth video. But anyway, one question I did want to get in, and you've sort of answered it a bit, but in a more specific context, when you go on a show where you know you're going to be disagreeing with people, given everything you've just said in the last hour, what is your strategy? Do you go in to make arguments that are designed for the audience? Are you making arguments that are designed to engage the person you're talking to and pull things out from them? So yeah, how do you do that given your worldview?
So debate is theater. One of the things that people really don't want to acknowledge is that debate is theater. So I tailor what I talk about to my audience, right? So when I was on CogDiss, my first appearance on Cognitive Dissonance, fantastic podcast, buddy podcast of mine, talking about safe spaces and trigger warnings, where, by the way, I give a fake source and make a total ass of myself and had to come back on to apologize. Goink! So in case you wondered if I was perfect, I am. But like in that first appearance, I'm dick joke buddy here to tell you about safe spaces, right? Dick joke, like, ugh, and then can you believe, yeah, blah, 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 right? Because that's who the audience, I know that's who the audience is. They're very similar to my audience, right? Morning radio, sound machine, that's how you have to communicate. On Seth's show, when I was talking about safe spaces, I came much more from a place of empathy. I came from a place of, look, hey, I'm the funny guy, right? Y'all heard about me on God Awful Movies. Now I'm back to tell you that I actually support these things, right? To give people pause. When in my debate with James, I was genuinely trying to do a formalized debate, right? An Oxford English style debate. It was casual. We didn't have a timekeeper, but like that's as close to like my debate training from high school as I've gotten, where I'm just like, here are my points. Here are this, you know, there's the occasional interruption when I realize that the form is a little loose, but that's an official debate. And my goal there was just like, here are these points presented reasonably with as much evidence as I could provide for people to look to like factual sources that I would represent it as someone who, as they like, that I would represent it as someone they liked, but that they could look and say, okay, this guy's getting serious with me. You know, when I was on David Smalley's show talking about Black Lives Matter, you know, and I love my buddy David Smalley, and we disagreed at the time. And since then, he's changed and moved his opinions forward in certain ways as well. But like my choice there was to try and make it more about us as human beings, right? To talk about, because he was talking about the experience, and I was trying to clarify terminology. So when I go on, I tailor it to the audience. You know, if I were to go on an anti-social justice YouTuber show, one of the things that I would probably try to acknowledge first is that a lot of what you don't hear, I really recommend it. Bo Burnham was on Pete Holmes's show, You Made It Weird. It's his third appearance. And on it, he talks about like class trying to divide us into race, and like how if you're a poor white guy, like hearing about white privilege, like even though it exists, and look, I can explain unpacking the backpack of white privilege fairly well at this point, but like if you don't know that metaphor and you don't understand it, and someone's just like, you racist son of a bitch, and you're like, I would like a house and food, right? And why? Because rich people want us to fight each other, right? So if I'm on an anti-social justice channel, one of the first things I want to do is I want to say that I connect. I want to communicate that I get it. And then I want to move towards my understanding of those terminologies and explore the bedrock a lot of the time for people of not giving a fuck. You know, usually when I talk to anti-social justice people, we'll get to the bedrock of not giving a fuck. And that's fine. That's usually where the disagreement is. I'll say, yeah, but this makes people feel bad. And they'll go, okay, I don't care. And that's fine. Like, then we've hit the bedrock of our disagreement, and then it's about exposing them to new people, right? If you don't care about gender pronouns because you think they're silly and they're stupid, right? And that's it, right? And that's the bedrock of your understanding. I introduce you to my friend Ari, right? Who is they and is fucking funny and awesome. And I introduce you to Callie, and I introduce you to all the awesome trans people in my life, or intersex people, or non-binary people in my life. And then, okay, well, I don't want my friend Ari to be sad. Fine. It's not that bad. And right, and we inch down, because that's how I learned, right? Yeah. I learned by meeting my trans friends my trans friend Jay, who is male but was born bio 6 female, right? And my buddy Jay was so patient with me. You know, when Jay was transitioning, I thought like he was wrong. And I kept being like, you sure you don't want to like see a therapist? And he was really cool about that with me. So again, I try to meet people where they are. Here, I can talk like super duper high level inside the circle, just like social justice warrior, right? I can use intersectionality. I can use those terms, right? I can talk about sort of the far limbs. And more importantly, like one of the things that you've obviously noticed is I try to talk about like our responsibility. Right? Because, yeah, can I shit on Thunderfoot all day? Sure. Right? I just sit here being like, and then he said this and I disagreed. And then this person said that and I disagreed. And Peter Boghossian's Twitter said that. And like, yeah, I could do that. And I'll feed meat to the lions. Right? Or I can talk about the harder, trickier things, which make me slightly less popular, obviously. But I could talk about those. So I do try to tailor it to the audience. But I always keep in mind, whatever conversation I'm having, it's theater. It's just theater. It's just theater, and you're playing to your audience. You're tailoring your bits, your jokes, your arguments to your audience. And throughout it all, my idea is, how do I make more people feel welcome through this? Now, there are times that I will say, just as an addendum, there are times that I won't necessarily platform people. I have had people be like, well, why don't you bring me on the Scathing Atheist and we can have this out? And first of all, we don't do debates on Scathing Atheist because debates are boring, and Scathing Atheist is a FUBU show. It's for us. It's by us. Like, no creationists allowed, right? And I don't want, like, some 19-year-old to be exposed to that many people who disagree with him, right? So a lot of the time, I will avoid platforming someone. But if I'm going to them, I try to go to them where they are and make it as safe an environment, as positive an environment as possible, even if we totally end up disagreeing. And if you want to see me fail at this, the first kid who made a video with me is this kid, a takedown video of me, is named Chairview. And me and Andrew Torres, who is on the amazing podcast Opening Arguments, Harvard-educated lawyer, we get on with him and this girl. And again, they're so sweet, and I'm not trying to shit talk them, but like, Andrew is a Harvard-educated lawyer, and he's explaining codes, like legal codes, to them, and he sends them the Wikipedia, because they just don't believe him, so he sends them a Wikipedia page, and she's like, oh, Wikipedia, really? And I stopped the conversation, and I was like, this is a Harvard, like, what are the chances? Like, how's high school going? You going to prom? Like, what are the chances you're right and he's wrong? And like, that's an example of me doing badly, but you can, like, everyone commented on that. And again, like, that was a situation where I was like, don't be abusive to this kid, because he's a kid. Yeah. He's a fucking kid. Do I think I won and he lost? Yes, but he's a baby. He's a baby. And I don't want that kid getting any abuse. I don't want that kid getting a single mean comment. You want to say, hey man, you were wrong? Sure. But I don't want a single mean word said to that kid, because I'm a safe person to challenge. So that's an example of me trying to meet an audience where they are, and at the end someone calls me a kike and tells me to meet them to fight, and that was bad, and that's where the conversation ended. Not on the thing, but in the chat someone was like, you're a kike, and I was like, all right, feel like we've not doing great here, moderator.
Don't watch the chat when you're on with Barron. Avoid the chat. Yeah.
All right, I will avoid the chat.
Yeah, just concentrate on the conversation.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if we were meant to go for an hour.
We were. I told Eli before we started, I said, we'll go about an hour because we've all got shit to do.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I cannot stop blathering, so no, forgive me.
No.
59 minutes of me chatting.
I could sit for another 59 minutes. That's fine. I enjoyed listening to your other interviews. And I really just, like, it's made me angry sometimes when people would cut you off or they change the topic. I'd be like, no, just let Eli talk. And that's when I realized I wanted to get on with you and Steve and have Steve talk a bit and me talk hardly at all and then just let Eli talk. So thank you for that.
Well, then you got your wish. And you're the only person. I found the one person who wants me to blather constantly.
Well, in 1 hour segments, you know.
This was about the perfect show then. I do have one last question for you though, Eli. And it's you've mentioned him a few times. It's about David A.R. White. I've figured out the reason that I don't like him. And it's not because he makes bad movies, although that's part of it. Mm-hmm. It's that he looks uncomfortably close to James Vanderbeek. And I really like James Vanderbeek. Damn
it's
it.
Too real. I can't associate those things.
I was a teenager when Dawson's Creek started and I loved that show. And now here's this guy making these awful Christian movies and he looks like James Vanderbeek's, you know, he looks like
James Vanderbeek stepped into the fly machine with a shovel. And then they came out the other side and it was like, ah,
what he reminds me of. It's here's the reference I was reaching for a second ago when you jumped in with a much funnier joke. He looks like Wayne Swayze, Patrick Swayze's older brother.
I get it.
No disrespect to Wayne Swayze
or deceased Patrick Swayze
or the great Patrick Swayze.
R.I.P. Patrick Swayze. May he be in heaven with our Lord and Savior.
He's ripping out throats with the angels now.
See, that's what I wanted. Not friend of the children, ripping out throats with the angels. If this goes terribly wrong,
if the angels need a throat ripped, they're going to call Eli.
Ripping out throats with the angels.
Yeah. I mean, next time I'll know. I'll go for Roadhouse instead of Gamera, and we'll be on the same page.
We'll be on the same page, exactly.
Gamera is really neat. Gamera is full of meat.
We are eating Gamera right now.
MST3K.
Okay. Well, anyway, Eli, thank you so much for joining us. Kristi, thank you so much for cooking up this harebrained idea.
It's fabulous.
Thank you so much, guys.
Absolutely. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Well, I don't know. We might do this again sometime.
Maybe. Oh, if Eli would like to, I would.
Yeah.
Anytime. I'll move my schedule.
If I'll even have him back. I mean,
exactly. Yeah. After you see all the dislikes, never have him on again.
Damn it. You know, you threw shade at Dan Errol, so he's right. Never.
And I started a feud with Cat Black. I'm the worst.
Like these, I like these people, Eli.
Right, exactly.
You know? I mean, you can't, you just can't come on my channel and do that shit.
I am the worst.
You can't do it. Okay, anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. Thanks, Eli and Kristi, for joining me, and we'll see you later.
Thanks so much.